Evening and Sunday evening, but we come to minister to the ones that are on the outside, so we don't have the luxury of a band, and we sing to regular tracks, amen, but we need your help, amen, as we worship God. Just come on and sing along with us, clap your hands, catch your feet, bob your head, do what you do, but give God some praise, amen, amen. We don't just start, we got all familiar songs. So you guys should know these songs, so you should be able to help us. Amen. As we worship God, as we lift our hands, we don't start out by lifting our hands in the sanctuary. We want to get that praise motor going. Amen. 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 Okay, let me find my song. here we go. All right, praise ye the Lord. God said that everything will have breath.
Oh God, once again. We come into your presence with expectancy in our hearts. God, we know you're going to bless us. So we lift our hands in the sanctuary and we give you glory and honor.
Yeah. And if you say yes, he'll be right there to help you.
Out of control. 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 Out of
you want a blessing, ask God for a blessing. Amen. Amen. You know, God wakes us up every day just to bless us. Amen.
Amen.
But he said, it's according to our faith. Amen. And then he said, faith without works is dead. So the best way to be blessed by God is to be grateful.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. How many grateful people in the house? Amen. If you want to be blessed, learn how to tell God thank you. Why should you keep it on the door? When you're not thinking before what he's already done. He said, for each day with praise and thanksgiving in your heart. Hallelujah. I know we're all going to love this song. So we're going to sing from our heart. Here we go. then we'll come back with one more song. I believe you guys to love God.
More than you need me.
right here too. We do our services right here. And we just celebrated our 13th year anniversary. And we acknowledge the church all the time. We acknowledge Pastor Tony and Sister Lucy giving us the covering and covering the ministry, amen? And so we didn't get a chance to give them their gift. So I want to bring the gift. I wanted to give it to them personally, just to give them saying thank you. They support us with food. We serve over 100 plates every time we come, and they've been supporting us with the food that used to come out of my fridge. And you know, there's a scripture in the Bible where God said that if you feed the homeless, the poor, God will withhold no good thing from you. So if you want to know how you can please God and serve God in a way that God will bless the ground, I promise you will bless the ground. I have to be here all day to talk about all the things that God has done in my life. So I'm encouraging you guys, this is part of this church. Our ministry is an outreach ministry of the Nazarene Church. So you guys are invited. I got one last song to share, and I'm going to sing this one solo. Amen. And just one last song. Let's see here. It's right here. Okay. Okay, let's try that one again. Alright, here we go, here we go. Hold on, this is the part that I don't like. Wait, no. Hold on, here we go, here we go. Thank you. Denise's favorite song. She's crying right now. Somebody know her.
You know, I believe this is the heart of the matter in the ministry, and that we have in ministry, that we keep guard on ourselves, that we're to be an example, Jesus. We're to shepherd the flock. Jesus purchased it, this church, with his own blood. You know what, I'm thankful. You know, I'm going to be very, very honest with you. I'm so thankful. When my brother told me that this message, the title of his message, Faith or Fear? What a time. What a time. What a time right now that we're living in. What a time that we're living in and everything that's going on. And I tell you what, I'm going to grab me a seat and I'm going to listen intently. And I pray that you and encourage you to open your heart up to him and the word of God that God has given him for you. Listen intently in this time. That what God has given him to bring to us this day. I want to give it to you, my brother Eugene.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good morning.
Hey, good morning.
How's everybody? God is good. I hope your mind is in the right place today, because you're in the right house. My pastor's not here today. I miss him. We're going to pray for him anyway. But I know that his heart is here. He may not be here, but I know that his heart is here. And I hope that your heart is here. So we're going to do one more song, but this is a congregational song. One that we all can sing together. And Brother Mark is getting ready to put it on right now. It's called I Sing Praises to Your Name. I'd like everyone to stand and sing this song that God has given us. If you can't stand, that's fine.
Same anointing in here is flowing.
Amen, amen.
Let's just begin to worship him now. Just for a few moments, let's entertain his presence. Let's worship him right now. Just give him glory. Close your eyes and lift your hands. Show me your own way. I bet you love him. Just lift your own way to the mercies.
But God is
good. Worship him, Jesus. We worship him, Jesus.
Your name is
precious, Jesus. Precious Jesus.
And greatly to be praised. Yeah.
the Lord a hand of applause. Give the Lord a hand of applause. Amen. You may have your seat. Now, wait a minute. Just stand. Let's go to God in prayer.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We come before your throne of grace and mercy and boldness with thanksgiving. We ask that you forgive us for any sins we have committed, knowing, unknown, in deed and in thoughts, past, present, or future. Thank you, O Lord, for manifesting that Spirit upon us and in us this day. Allow our spirit to lead and guide us according to your will, according to thy precepts and thy concepts. Allow me to decrease as your Holy Spirit increases. Let every word that comes from my mouth be of you and nothing of myself. We thank you for all you have done, all you are doing, and all you are going to do in our lives in the name of Jesus. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, we pray. And everybody who agree with this prayer can say,
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Wow. Solid.
It feels so good to be here with you today. God is good. Amen. I was doing a Sunday school lesson, and in the Sunday school lesson, the title was insult to injury, and it came out of the book of Job, you know. And so I said to myself, I said, well, look, I got to do the Sunday school lesson and I have to minister the word, so why not combine it? Let's do a little bit more of Job and keep pushing. Amen.
Amen.
In the book of Job, we know that God allowed Job to face turmoil in his life. God considered Job as a righteous man. Amen. God knew the heart of Job. God knew the heart of Job. In Hebrews 4:12, it said this. It says, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of souls and spirit, of the joint and marrow, and a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. He said, a discerner of the thoughts and the intent of your heart. God already knows what you're thinking before you make it. God already knows what you're going to do before you do it. He knows your intent. He knows what you're trying to do. He knows whether you're going to go to the left or to the right. God knows already. In other words, God knows what you're going to do, no matter what it may be. Whether it's good, whether it's bad. God already knows. Amen?
Amen.
Since God knew Job, God allowed him to be to the test of faith. God offered Job up to Satan. He said, Satan had came into the midst of the gathering where God and the sons of God was having a meeting, and he said, Satan, have you considered my servant Job? Satan knew he could not touch Job. Satan knew this. Job was completely surrounded by the Holy Spirit. Satan knew that. He had the power of God protecting him. And so Satan knew these things. He knew even when you were walking in faith, when you are walking in righteousness, when you are walking up under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, there is a safety net, a protection around you that comes from above and not from below. Come from God and God alone. And God do not allow no one to touch you.
Amen.
Unless there is a purpose
yeah.
Satan considered Job on one condition. One condition. That God remove his shield of protection. Job was an honorable man. God blessed him. Everything that his hands touched, God blessed him. He had an abundance of everything. He had children, livestock, land, houses, and above all, he was covered by the Holy Spirit. He had everything this world could possibly offer from God and the protection of the Holy Spirit surrounding him. In the time that Job was living, you know, they didn't need a whole lot, but he had a whole lot. He had a gang of children, about 10 or 11 of them. He had all kind of lambs and horses and all kind of livestock. He had a lot of land, and on that land he had houses. His children lived in those houses. He had everything that you need, you know. This is a firm and complete understanding that God is sovereign and have total control over everything. God has control over everything. He has the power over life and death. But God stroked Job of Satan's ego. He stroked his ego. In 1 Corinthians 10:23, it says this, "There had no temptation taken you, but such is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you may be able to bear it." So God was throwing Job in the fire, but he wasn't forsaking him. He didn't leave him. He removed the protection shield with one condition. See, that one condition is something that him and Satan agreed on. That Satan, he removed the protection shield with the condition that Satan could not take his life. So this within itself lets you know that God has the power over life and the power over death. Satan can't move unless God allowed him to move. See, Satan is up under the thumb of God just like you are under the hand of God. When God tells Satan to move, he got to move. Satan's scared. He's scared. The agreement was between God and Satan. Satan went on a mission and destroyed all that Job had. His children, his livestock, his property with houses, and plagued him with disease and sickness. And to make things worse, after that, after Satan had did all of that, in Job chapter 2 verse 9, Job's wife said, asked him, "If he still maintained his integrity, and why don't you curse God and die?" Wow. Now you're talking about adding insult to injury. Huh? This man has been beat down. Everything has been taken away from him. Everything of this world has been taken away from him. And his own wife is going to say, "Are you still standing in your integrity? Why don't you just curse God and die?" That was a cold blow, wasn't it? That was a cold blow. And after that encounter with his wife, his four best friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar, and Elihu, came to him with criticism and accusations of what could have caused the situation to happen. They had no idea of what they were speaking and what Job was experiencing. They had no idea. They don't know the heart of God. They don't know the mind of God. You know, God says, so is the heavens higher than the earth. So is my thoughts higher than your thoughts. So is my ways higher than your ways. We don't know what God's mind is unless you study his word. Amen. Because this is what God gives you. A piece of his mind. Yeah. But through it all, Job was steadfast in his speaking and what Job was experiencing. But through it all, Job was correction. So today, I want to ask you, where are you? Are you standing in faith? Are you living in fear? Do you trust God? Or do you trust yourself or the world?
No.
Do you walk in faith or do you live in fear? Ladies and gentlemen, the title of the message today is Faith or Fear? Faith or Fear? We're coming out of the book of Luke, chapter 8, verses 22 through 25. Luke, chapter 8, verses 22 through 25. And the word of God reads like this.
Let me get everybody standing, please. Everybody standing.
If you got a bad leg fighting me, sit down. Now, like I said, if you can stand, stand. But if you got bad legs like me, sit down. Yeah. Now it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples. And he said unto them, let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And there came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. In other words, we die. Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the raging of the water. And they ceased, and there was a calm. And he said unto them, where is your faith? And they are being afraid, wondering, saying, one to another, what manner of man is this? For he commanded even the wind and the water, and they obeyed him. He spoke to the winds and the water and obeyed him. That's what he said. The Greek word for fear is one you guys hear all the time. Phobia. Phobia.
That's Greek.
Yes, it is. Look it up. Look it up. Everybody has some type of phobia most of the time, don't they?
Yeah.
Something that they fear, huh?
Yeah.
It's something that people fear. In this world, amen? As we can see, Jesus and his disciples was on the bank of the Sea of Galilee. Many of these disciples grew up in this area on the waters around the Sea of Galilee. Their families made a living as fishermen. But this was different circumstances than before. As they were crossing to the other side, they encountered this storm to happen to be a natural calamity, but strong and invoked fear in their life because water was coming in the boat. So if the boat is filling up with water, they already got their feet wet, they're scared. Oh my God, we're gonna sink. But I mean, they've been around that sea all their life, they've been fishing in that sea all their life. I'm quite sure they can swim. But it's a sea. You see, When they talk about it, it's not from here to that door right there. I grew up around the ocean and the sea in Florida, and I know how long it is when you're trying to go from one side to the other. That's a lot of water in between there. When you get out of the cellar, you're talking 1,200, 1,400, 1,800 feet deep. You talk about deep. And so that's a sea. See? So Jesus was laying down asleep, and he woke him up. They woke him up out of his sleep. And if they looked over at him and said, well, he's sleeping, ain't nothing to fear. Well, what is it to fear? He just laying there sleeping. Let's lay down beside him. Get us some sleep too. But no, that's not the mind of man. Man don't think the way God thinks. Amen? Amen. And Jesus spoke and he stopped. And they just looked at him. Just looked at him and said, what manner of man is this? What kind of person is this? Jesus is not holding his disciples responsible for the storm. He is holding them responsible for their response to the storm. They have given in to a very human fear. They were afraid they were going to die. But what is it that they don't understand? This is what happened. After seeing him heal the blind, after seeing him heal the lame, after seeing him heal the sick, after seeing him feed 4,000 and others, after seeing him feed 5,000 and others, what does it take for them to acknowledge the importance of faith in God? Everything Jesus did in miracles mostly, he prayed. And he was showing them that you have to put your faith in our mind. Even though God was right there walking with him, you got the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Jesus respected that order. And he was trying to show them, well, you need to respect the order. Anything that you need, anything that you ask for, you go to God and pray. He will give it to you. The importance of trust in God and believing God. There are many types of storms in our life. A storm can be any problem that occurs. It is called a storm. People call that a storm in your life. When you understand that faith does not prevent the storm of life that we face, we are going to continue to go through storms. Faith don't prevent it. The enemy causes the storm. The enemy can stir up storms around your life. He can bring you under severe attack. Your faith in God will not prevent this attack from the enemy, but may rather attract them. What do they mean by that? It may attract them, huh? Well, God put Job out there. He put him out there, right? God put Job out there. Have you considered my servant Job? And then what he said? Have you considered? And that's why he said, hey, you know, you go ahead and deal with him. You know, you asked me to take my power from around him, so I'll do that, no problem. Because we know who God is. We know who he is. Everything Satan thinks he can take from you, God can replenish it tenfold, 20-fold, 50-fold. God can. 100-fold, my sister. You know, there's nothing that God can't replace in your life. Nothing that you can't replace. So he will allow Satan to go on his rampage and dealing with people and bringing them down and taking from them, you know. But 1 Corinthians 16:13 says this: be on the alert, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, watch. That's what it's saying. Be vigilant, be vigilant, be steadfast in your faith. Be a man and stand up for your belief. Don't let small matters or worldly matters move you to the point of losing faith. Whatever you face, whatever you're going through, whatever problem that you're dealing with, trust in God. Know in your heart and your mind that he's going to bring you out. When you trust in him, he will fulfill your prayer. He will bless you, protect you. Everything that you need will come for him. But Luke 1:37 says, but with God, nothing shall be impossible. If God is for you, tell me who can be against you. If God is for you, who can be against you? There's not one can stand against the Almighty. You are covered by the blood. The blood that will never lose his power. Amen? We have to know this in our hearts, in our minds, in our souls. We got to know that God got us. We got to know that God got your back as long as you walking uprightly, as long as you doing the things that he called you to do, as long as you studying his word and feeding your mind with his word, as long as you walking according to his precept and his concept, as long as you put God first, the head and not the tail, as long as you taking God on and on and on in everything you do and everywhere you go, let God be the head and not the tail.
That's right. Amen.
As long as God is there, as long as God is with you, you have nothing to worry about. He might let you fall down, but guess what? He's the one going to pick you up.
Yes, yes.
He's going to pick you up.
Yes.
Because he knows your heart. He know your mind. He know where your soul is. He know that you trust in him. He know that you believe in him. In Proverbs 3:6, it says, trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not to thy own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path.
Yes, yes.
It says, in all your ways, not in some of them. Not in a few of them. In all of them.
Yes.
Put God first.
Yes.
God knows exactly what you're doing when you do it.
Yeah.
He knows it. You can't lie to God. Huh? You can't play no games with God. Games come from the world. Games come from Satan. Satan will play the game with you. He sure will. Trust God completely. Do not let your mind waver back and forth. The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Your mind has to be steadfast on Jesus. Steadfast. In 2 Corinthians 5:7 it says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Walking in faith is referring to allowing your faith to dictate your life daily. Daily, every day that God gives you. You have completely surrendered your life to God. Galatians 6:9 says this, and let us not grow weary of doing good. For in due season we will reap. And we do not give up. Huh?
Yeah.
That word reap, what does it mean? That word reap, in due season, when the time come, huh? Goodness will come to you.
Yes, Lord.
For the goodness that came out of you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Goodness will come to you for the goodness that come out of you.
Yes.
If you fight the good fight of faith, if you endure the good fight of faith, your heavenly Father will reward you justly. You will reap what you have sown.
Amen.
If you sow goodness, you reap goodness. If you sow evil, you reap evil. That's what it's telling us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
So the thing is, you're paying yourself.
Amen.
Huh? You're paying yourself. If you know you sow goodness, you reap goodness, you sow evil, you reap evil, then you are deciding, because God don't take away your free will. He allowed you to make a decision. And if you, within that decision, decide you want to do evil things, then already know that somewhere that evil is going to come back upon you. And I'm talking about hard. See, the evil that you put out there, it's not like the evil that God will allow to hit you. Just to turn you around. Just to get you to know that He is God.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
That's why in many things we do, we fall down and we call on Him and He say, my child, just get up. Just get up. Just get up. That's what He said. Jesus is right there. Every step you take, every move you make, He's right there. And when you fall down, He got His hand extended to you. All you got to do is say, Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. He said He was lost, but now you found.
Huh?
But now you found. Is real about His.
Yes.
But you got to be real about yours. Philippians 3, 4, 13, 14 says this, brother, I do not consider that I have made it my own. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Say, what? I press on. See, I'm constantly seeking that prize, that present, that love that God has for me, that thing that God has for me. Jesus said, where I go, you can go also. He said, but you gotta pick up your cross and you got to carry it. You gotta pick up your cross. He said, pick it up and follow me. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. He said, I'll put the footstep right there for you to follow. He said, I'm leaving these steps right here for you to follow. He said, these steps are the steps that lead to the righteousness of the God that you're serving. But if you swing to the left or to the right, you're going to be off course. Don't get off course. He said, I'm giving you a guideline. This is my GPS. For you, right here, is laid out for you. All you got to do is punch the button. All you got to do is step up. All you got to do is walk in that path. All you got to do is live in that path. All you got to do is make that path yours. Make that path the one that's going to lift you up out of the worldly ways and put you in the heavenly realm.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
God don't joke. Jesus ain't no joke. Look at your life every day and say, hey, time's coming. Because guess what? We all going to die. In this world, we all going. And we don't know the day nor the time. We don't know. You know, we wake up with that stupidity. The Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. That's what the Bible teaches you. Because for the simple fact that God don't want you to wake up in that array of anger. That means you holding on to something that you didn't let go, and it ain't gonna do nothing to break you down. It's gonna break you down. So when God said you're gonna let the sun go down on anger, he means, hey look, this day is over. Throw out what happened today with today. And if I wake you up in the morning, wake up in peace. Wake up in love. Wake up in joy. Wake up with a new beginning. Wake up with understanding. Wake up with wisdom. Walk according to my way and my word. Be filled by the Holy Spirit. Wake up where you can feel the goodness of God all over you. Every morning God touch you. Bam, my son, at that time is a new day for you. I am ready to take you home right now. So I'm waking you up.
Amen.
Yes. And when he touch you and wake you up, then you need to wake up.
Yes.
You need to wake up. Forget yesterday. Because you can't go back there and change it. You can't go back there and change it. It's finished. It's done. And since he woke you up today, make it a good day. Because you don't know if tomorrow is promised. You don't know if tomorrow is promised. So make this day a good day. Live this day like you never lived one in your life. See, and every time God wakes you up, live that way. But because if he decided to call you home when you sleep, well, if he called me home, y'all won't see me. You may see this body before it goes on the ground, but you won't see me. Because this spirit in here, I'm about to say absent from the body is what? God, say that again, absent from the body is what? Present with the Lord. I'll be smiling good. I said, you done took me out of that hell now, man. Lord, you done brought me up. I mean, you done brought me up. They got me smiling with you. Look at Jesus over there. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You done brought me up here. And I'll be like, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. But for you, I was able to be saved. Salvation was through you. Thank you. I'm here to thank you. Because I believe in everything that you said and everything that you put out there for me to read and understand. Then lead me. I believe in the book of life.
Yes, Lord. Right there. Right there. I believe in the book of life.
I believe that.
Yes, Lord. Say that.
And I lived it. And I got my reward.
Amen.
We want a reward. A reward. From God. We want the reward that God promised us. Every time you get into your car and you look in the glove compartment, you got a manual in there and say, well, this is how this car operates. You buy a brand new bicycle, you got a little manual hanging on and say, well, this is how this bicycle operates. I'm a motorcycle. Oh, and you can buy any type of cooking equipment and be like, well, this is how this operates. It's called an operational manual. We have an operational manual. It's called BIBLE, Biblical Instruction Before Leaving Earth. We have an operation manual. And if you read it, if you study it, if you let the word come alive in you, if you let the word begin to guide you, if you begin to live according to the word, if you let this word manifest itself in your body, in your mind, in your soul, if every day you wake up, you giving him thanks, you praising him, you know, and you walking, you know, in his concepts and his precepts. Guess what? This word is going to lead you home. This word is going to lead you home, because this is the trail to home, the way, the truth, and the life. The path that will take you to everlasting.
Forever.
Everlasting.
Yeah.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
In James 1, 2, and 4, it says, count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in anything. Count it all joy. When you're walking up under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, count it all joy. When you are tested by Satan and you stand on the word of God as Jesus did, count it all joy. You see, we are not the only ones that are tempted, but even Jesus, after he came up out of the baptism of John the Baptist, the Spirit descended on him in the form of a dove and empowered him. And then the Spirit led him up in the wilderness where he was tempted 40 days and 40 nights.
Right.
He was tested. But this is God being tested.
Yeah.
This is God being tested. And Satan comes and takes, and he looked at Satan and said, look, man can't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Know how to live in this world, regardless of everything that's going on and everything that may look good and everything may seem like it is good to you. Because it's not. It's not. The only thing that's good to you and for you is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. In 1 Corinthians 14:23, 14:33, it says this: for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the same. We say God is not leading you out there to get caught up into something. God is not guiding you when you do something that's going to take you behind the prison walls of in there, I know. God is not doing anything to create confusion in your life. Because he gives you everything to avoid all confusion.
Amen.
If you let the deeds of the world control your life, you're walking in the fear and in sin. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. The Bible says walk in the Spirit that you don't fulfill the deeds of the flesh. Have faith and preserve that you may reap the benefits of life. Have faith and preserve that you may reap the benefit of life. Do not let fear control you. Worldly fear is not of God. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. Worldly fear is not of God. Ladies and gentlemen, the title of this message today is Faith or Fear. God bless you.
Yes, sir.